All right. Yes. Again, thank you. Thank you for your flexibility and joining me at this time now. And if you're watching the video, you know, I apologize that I had to kind of make this last minute change here. I have to actually, the air conditioner at my home is in need of some service. And so the AC people, they said their only availability was during our class time. So that's why I had to reschedule. But anyway, I guess that's one of the perks of teaching remotely is, you know, everything's recorded and you guys can watch. So anyway, so thanks for being here. All right, today's lecture is going to be on floating point numbers and floating point numbers. We're at the point in kind of the course where we take a little bit of a thematic shift and we move away from kind of programming concepts and dealing with R packages and things like that and start getting into, you know, statistical computation where we look at computational aspects and statistics. And any discussion of, you know, dealing with numbers with a computer requires a, you know, a base understanding of how numbers are even stored in computers. And so one thing we have to recognize is that, you know, throughout all of your math education is that you've been dealing with the real number line, okay? And as far as computers go, we are not able to actually store real numbers, right? So if you think about, you know, the real numbers, you have infinitely many values, right? And if you think of just kind of two numbers on the real number line, there's also infinitely many values between them, right? So how many values are between 0 and 1? There's infinitely many. How many values are between 1 and 1.1? There's infinitely many. And you know, whatever number you can think of, some numbers can have decimal places that go on, you know, an infinite number of decimal places, right? You know, pi, famously, you know, people are trying to calculate, you know, whatever, you know, 100 billionth value of digit of pi and things like that. And there's just infinitely many values. And so, you know, as far as the computer goes, we're not able to store these real numbers in their full infinite sense, okay? But throughout all of your kind of learning the math rules and things like that, everything's been applied to real numbers. So, you know, these are some very, very kind of basic properties of real numbers that we have kind of taken for granted, right? So you have associativity, where you can say A plus B plus C, A plus B, you know, associated first plus C is the same as, you know, you associate B and C first and then add A, and same thing with multiplication. Or if you do A times B plus C, that's the same thing as A times B plus A times C. And, you know, you have this commutative property where A plus B is the same as B plus A and A times B is the same as B times A. And, you know, we expect all of these rules to be true. And they are true when you're dealing with real numbers. And when you have real numbers, you have decimal, every real number has a decimal representation, right? Basically, and I don't know when you guys learned this, but probably in like second or third grade, you learn maybe, I don't know, fourth grade, I don't know. You learn about like you have the ones place and the tens place and the hundredth place and the thousandths place, but then you also have the tenths place and the hundredths place and the thousandths place. Meaning, so this is, you know, 5 times 1,000 plus 4 times 100 plus 1 times 10 plus 3 times 1 plus 2 times 0.1 and 9 times 0.9. And so, you know, everything can be represented via decimals. And this is kind of how we would do this. You know, symbolically, we would say, you know, any number is you'd have, you know, basically a sign, whether it's positive or negative. And then you basically take every kind of element, okay, multiplied by 10 to some k, where k is, you know, going to go anywhere from negative 2 to 3 in this case, or, you know, whatever, however many values you have, right? And this could be infinitely, infinitely long. Let me go ahead and give you your very first view quiz answer for today. Today's first view quiz answer is the letter D. D as in dog. D as in dog is your first view quiz answer for today. So today is week four, Wednesday. Week four. I guess we're two-thirds of the way through our course now. Week four, Wednesday. D as in dog is your first view quiz answer. Okay. And then, so you have decimal notation. You also have scientific notation. So if you have this number 5413.29, okay, you could represent that as 5.41329 times 10 to the third, okay? And so as far as scientific notation, basically you have some kind of sign plus this, this part, which we might call the mantissa, or the significand, whatever we call it, and we multiply it by 10 to some power, the exponent, the order of magnitude, okay? And normally when we do scientific notation, it's done in such a way that this first digit, that you only have basically one digit in front of the decimal, and this first digit is not zero. It has to be, you know, some value 1 through 9 for the first one, and you know, and then you have everything else in times 10 to the something here. Okay, so you know, this would be non-normalized scientific notation. These two things are equivalent, but the normalized scientific notation, you have one value here, and it's not a zero. And so here it's going to be 5.41329 times 10 to the third, things like that. And it's useful when you have, you know, really big or really small numbers like Avogadro's number and, you know, whatever else you have here, like the Planck constant and things like that. Okay. So a lot of numbers that we deal with have finite decimal representations, like 1/2. You can represent with 0.5, no problem, okay? And that's exactly equal to 1/2, okay? But pretty much all irrational numbers, and some of the rational numbers have infinite decimal representations. So if you think of square root 2, you think of pi, those decimal values, they go on to infinity, okay? And then even to get the number 1/3 represented perfectly in decimal form, there is a decimal form, but it has infinitely many decimals, right? It goes 0.33333333, and you have to have those threes go on forever, okay? So basically, every time we write a decimal representation for some number like this, it's just going to be an approximation. It's going to be an approximation, and this, the fact that we're doing approximations of these things actually make a huge difference as far as kind of the properties for real numbers, okay? And we have to keep in mind that computers can't store any value with infinite precision, right? Like if you think about what it would take to store all the digits of pi, it's not possible. It's physically impossible, because you know, you could have your entire hard drive. You can have like a, you know, a 10 terabyte hard drive, you know, and use it to store as many digits of pi, but you would not have all of them, right? You're going to run out of space at some point. And so, we can't store infinitely many values, okay? And so everything that we store on our computer has to be an approximate representation. And just for kind of the fact of kind of keeping our computations efficiently decided, you know, the engineers decided we're going to use 8 bits of precision. Okay. And, you know, computers technically store everything in binary representation, base 2 instead of base 10, but the effects of an approximate storage, the ideas of what happens when you have approximate storage, you know, applies both in base 2 and in base 10. Okay, so I have an example here. Okay, so here's this old calculator, and I actually have a video of basically what happens. But if you have an old calculator, you might have experienced some of the limitations or some of the odd quirks of using a calculator with basically approximate storage, right? So here I have, I'm gonna do the number 10 and I'm gonna divide it by 3. And what am I gonna get? I'm gonna get 3.33333. And if I multiply that by 3, what do I get? I don't get 10 back, I get 9.99999. Okay, here's a video that kind of shows the exact same thing. So here I'm gonna do 10 in the calculator. I divide by 3. I get 3.333. If I take that and I multiply by 3, I get 9.999, okay? So that's, I don't know if you guys experienced something like that when working with calculators as a student, okay? But if you do 10 divided by 3 times 3 on your calculator, you don't get 10 back, you get something a little bit off, okay? 9.999, right? Whereas if you do the opposite, if you do 10 times 3 and then divide by 3, okay? So if I do 10 times 3, this seems silly to do, but 10 times 3 gives me 30. If I do 30 divided by 3, I get 10, okay? So over here, 10 divided by 3 times 3 doesn't give me 10 back. It gives me 9.999. And over here, when I do 10 times 3 divided by 3, I get 10 back, okay? And so the fact that we're getting different results here, right? This basically breaks one of the rules that we have in for real numbers, right? With real numbers, 10 divided by 3 times 3 should be exactly the same as 10 times 3 divided by 3, right? We're basically multiplying by a third and then multiplying by 3, or multiplying by 3 and multiplying by a third. For real numbers, which order you do these things in don't matter, okay? But when we're dealing with approximations, approximate representations, which is what happens when we have a calculator, and which is what happens internally when we have a computer, these rules get broken, all right? And so so I think it's important that we recognize that, and it's important that we understand kind of, you know, some of the systems that how this works, right? So, you know, other examples. So if you do the square root of 2 on the calculator and you square it, so you square it, you hit times times equals. So 2 square root is this. And when you square it, you get 1.998, okay? So again, you can do the square root of 2 gives you that, and you square it and you get that, okay? And then the opposite, you know, this is almost very silly to do because obviously it's gonna do exactly what we expect. When you square 2, you get 4. When you take the square root of 4, you get 2, okay? So that's not a surprise, but again, these break the rules that that otherwise are true for real numbers. Okay, and so in R, we have this very sophisticated, kind of like a calculator in R, okay? But you still end up getting some of these strange artifacts. Let me go ahead and zoom in a few times here, okay? And so if I do this, right? So I'm gonna say, let's store 0.1 as the value A in R, okay? It's not a trick, all right? So I can say, all right, let's print A and I get 0.1. All right, let's ask, what is B? So we're gonna set B equal to 0.3 divided by 3, okay? So if I print out B, you know, 0.3 divided by 3 looks like 0.1 as well, okay? But then if I ask, is A equal to B, it comes back false. These two values are not actually equal. And you say, well, are you sure? You know, here's A. A is that. A is 0.1. B is 0.1. Is A equal to B? And we're getting false, right? And we can ask, is 0.1 equal to 0.1? That's true. Is A equal to 0.1? That's true. What's B? B is that. But is B equal to 0.1? And that comes back false, right? And so this seems a little bit strange, a little bit bizarre, but this is what's happening. We're basically what's happening here is that this B is not actually 0.1. It's something very close to 0.1, but it's not really, right? Just in the same way that on my calculator, 9.9999999 is not actually 10, okay? And you know, the display settings kind of make it look like it's 10, but it's actually internally, it's stored as something like 9.9999999, okay? And we can, so here I just kind of, this shows out basically what we've played around with. Here's another scenario. Let me use different letters. I'm gonna set X equal to 0.1 plus 0.2. So what's X? X is 0.3. I'm going to set y equal to 0.3, okay? So what's y? And so here's x. X is, looks like it's 0.3. Y looks like it's 0.3. But if I do x, is x equal to y, I get back false, okay? I get back false, right? And again, it's something that is similar to 0.3, but internally, the way it's stored is it's not actually equal to 0.3, okay? Just another example, if you make a sequence from 0 to 1 by 0.1, and you get the sequence 0, 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, 0.4, 0.5, and you say, okay, well, what's the fourth element? The fourth element here is 0.3, and let's say B is equal to 0.3. Is this 0.3 equal to this 0.3? And the answer there is also false, right? So here we said make a sequence going from 0 to 1, but this element is 0.3, S4 is 0.3, is that equal to 0.3? And it turns out, no, it's not, right? And so this is very confusing, right? And I've got even more examples, right? I've got a bunch of these things, right? 4 divided by 5 times 3 times 5 divided by 4. So it's like 4/5 times 3 times 5/4. That looks like it's equal to 3. And then here I have 4/5 times, and I'm just doing some associativity. 3 times 5/4, okay? So again, with real numbers, these two things would be exactly equal, but on the computer, internally, something is happening where even though it looks like a 3 here and it looks like a 3 here, they're not actually equal to each other. They're not actually equal to each other, okay? And so, you know, one thing that kind of reveals a little bit of what's happening is you could set one of your options, right? So you can do options, digits equal 20, okay? And so we can go back and ask, what was A equal to, right? Remember, so A was this, and what is B equal to? And we're getting two values that both of them are close to 0.1, but they're not exactly equal to 0.1, right? So if I do 0.1, I get this. And if I do 0.3 divided by 3, I get this, right? So these two things are stored differently inside the computer. And so these two things are not equal. And that's why if I say, is A equal to B, it comes back false, okay? But again, when you have the options, if options digits is not set to 20, but it's, you know, probably defaults to something around 8, you ask for what is A and you ask for what is B, they both look like 0.1, but internally what's being stored is something that's not exactly 0.1. You get something, because as far as, you know, just like on this calculator, am I able to store 10 divided by 3 exactly? I can't, right? If I try to say, can I store the value 1 over 3 exactly? I can't. I'm gonna just get a whole bunch of decimals, I'm going to get 0.333333, which is close, pretty close to one third, but it's not exactly that, right? And similarly, as far as binary notation, with finite binary notation, you can't actually represent the number 0.1 exactly, okay? The number 0.5, you can, so if I did 1 divided by 2, I can get 0.5 exactly, okay? 1 divided by 3 or 1 divided by 10, I can't get exactly, okay? 1 divided by 2, I can get exactly. 1 divided by 4, I can get exactly. 1 divided by, basically 1 over any kind of power of 2, I can get the exact value here in binary notation. But something like 1 over 10, I can't get the exact notation, right? Just like with the decimal calculator, you can do 1 divided by 10, 1 divided by 100, and get exact representations of those things. But if you try to do 1 divided by 3, you're not going to get an exact representation. You're going to get something that's an approximate representation. And similarly, if I do 1 over 10 here or 1 over 3 here, in binary notation, when it gets stored internally binary, I'm not getting an exact representation. And that's basically what's going on here, okay? And so, you know, if you think about this, here I've got 0.3, 0.4 minus 0.1, 0.5 minus 0.2, 0.6 minus 0.3, 0.7 minus 0.4. It all looks like 0.3, 0.3, 0.3, but how many of these are actually distinct from each other? And there's actually, you know, there's actually three different representations of 0.3. We have 0.299999, we have 0.30004, and we also have 0.299999 and ends in a 3, okay? So there's different kind of, there's three different representations of 0.3, you know, as far as, you know, just kind of looking at these values here. You know, 0.7 minus 0.4 results in this. And 0.4 minus 0.1 ends up in this. So it's hard to know what's gonna happen. And you don't really know exactly, you know, I don't think we're gonna have such a quick understanding of binary representation to be able to know instantly just by looking at this, that there's gonna be three different representations. But what we can do is when we write our code, when we write checks to test for equality, we can keep in mind that we might get values that are off by, you know, 10 to the minus 16 or some very small quantity. And therefore, checks for equality shouldn't be to see if they are exactly equal, but just to see if they are approximately equal, okay? All right, and so when we represent a number in binary, okay, basically all the values, it's kind of like decimal representation, except we're in base 2, right? So everything gets represented with a 0 or a 1, and everything is basically a power of 2, okay? So when you count in binary, it starts off as 0000 for 0, and then basically, the ones digit will alternate between 0 and 1, 0, 1, 0, 1. And then this will represent the twos. This represents the 2 to the 2 squared, which will be the fours. And this will represent the eighths place, 2 to the third, the eighths place, right? So here, let's just take a look at this, right? If we want to represent the number 11, the number 11 in binary is represented with 1, 0, 1, 1. Okay, you have, it's 2 to the zeros is the ones place, 2 to the 1, which is the 2's place, 2 to the 2 squared, which is the 4's place, and 2 cubed is the 8's place. And so 8 is represented with 1, 0, 1, 1, which is 1, 8, 0, 4's, 1, 2, and 1, 1. So 8 plus 0 plus 2 plus 1 is equal to 11. Okay, and so that's what we have here. And if you count them, you know, you can kind of count on your fingers. So this is 0, this would be 1, this would be 2, this would be 3, this would be 4, this would be 5, 6, 7, right? And then at 8, I have an 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. Okay. And then now I can count with a, okay. And then you can keep going. 16, 17, 18, 19, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, and so on and so forth, right? So it's just kind of the ones place. And so this is 1, 1, 2 is 1, 2, and 0, 3 is 1, 2, and 1, 1. This is now the fours place. 5 is a 4 and a 1. 6 is a 4 and a 2. 7 is 4 and 2 and 1. 8 is 8. 9 is 8 and 1. 10 is 8 and 2. 11 is 8, 2 and 1. 12 is 8 and 4. 13 is 8, 4 and 1. 14 is 8, 4, 2. And 15 is 8, 4, 2, 1. Okay. And now we can represent decimals too. Okay. And so, and for decimals, we have the halves place, the quarters place, the eighths place, and the sixteenths place, and so on and so forth, right? So if you want to represent one half or decimal 0.5, in binary, that would be 0.1, okay? So this is the decimal point, and this over here would be called a binary point. But just to kind of keep it clear, I'm just going to call it the point, right? So one half would be 0.1, one quarter would be 0.01, okay? 0.01 represents one quarter, and 1/8 would represent 0.001. Okay, 0.375 in decimal is the equivalent of 3/8. 3/8 would be equal to 0.011, which is 1/4. And 1/8, 1/4 here, and 1/8 would be 0.011, and that would be equal to 3/8 right there. Okay, I just want to kind of just check in with you guys here and make sure that this finite binary representation makes sense, because this is going to be important. So maybe I should just back up and just make sure that binary representation of these integers makes sense, and finite binary representation of these kind of these fractional values also makes sense. Okay, nobody's responding, but okay, I got one thumbs up there. All right, thank you, I appreciate that. Okay, and so just like in decimal representation, pretty much, you know, most of the values on the number line have some infinite decimal representation, and most of the number lines will have infinite binary representation, okay? And so if you wanted to represent the decimal value 0.1, 1 divided by 10, in binary, it would have to be something like this, 0.00011001100110011. And it's this repeating pattern. And, you know, kind of like we would write 0.3333333, we might put a bar over the 3 to represent that the 3s go on forever. You know, you could put a bar over the 0011 and represent, say that they go on forever. But, you know, again, as far as computers go, and you know, as far as these old calculators go, you can't have 0.333 going on forever. It runs out after, I think, 8 places on the screen. And similarly, on the computer, we can't have 0.00110011 going on forever. It runs out of space. And the way we have it set up, it runs out after doing 52 digits and things like that, okay? So the decimal represent, the decimal number 0.1, okay, 1/10 in a computer is always going to be represented by a finite number of digits, and it's always going to be an approximate value, right? And this is why we end up getting these kind of these weird things, these seemingly weird things on the computer where you do 0.1 and 0.2 and you're expecting it to equal 0.3, but they're not exactly equal. It's because this is an approximate representation. This is an approximate representation. And when you add these two approximations, the value you get, excuse me, you have an approximation for point one, an approximation for point two, and when you add those approximations together, what they add up to is not exactly the same thing as the approximation that we have for point three. And that's basically what's going on here, okay? And so let's delve into exactly how the numbers are stored in the computer. And so, at first, when computers were first being developed, there wasn't a standardized thing on how numbers should get represented, okay? And it wasn't too big of a deal because pretty much people wrote software specifically for one machine, and they wouldn't expect it to like be used on a different machine. But then they realized, you know what? We want to be able to have kind of our programs that run on one machine also work for this machine and not have to rewrite everything. And so basically the group of engineers, the IEEE, which is the, Institute, I don't know, whatever, something of electrical engineers and stuff, they developed this standard, the IEEE 754 standard for how to represent numbers, floating point numbers in the computer. This is implemented at a hardware level, okay? And it's done on the computer chip itself. And so whether you are using Python or R or C or whatever it is on your machine, basically all of these floating point numbers are gonna get stored the same way on your computer, okay? And pretty much all computers today, whether it's an Intel computer or if you have an Apple Silicon, it used to be all Apple computers used Intel as well. But also, your phones, they all kind of comply to this standard. I can't imagine a modern chip manufacturer using a different standard for storing their numbers. So everything kind of conforms to the standard. They've made a few revisions to it. Okay. But what we're going to do is we're going to discuss the original specification of the IEEE 754 standard, the 1985 specification, and that's still fully contained in the 2008 revision. Okay. You can read about it. There's a good lengthy article on Wikipedia, but we'll take a look. Okay. And so the way floating point numbers get represented, okay, in binary notation is you have a sign, okay, whether it's going to be positive or negative. So you have a sign bit, okay? And then you kind of think of scientific notation, right? In scientific notation, we had that number 5,413 represented as 5.413 times 10 to the third and something like that. Basically, we have something like that here, except it's binary. And if it's binary and scientific notation, this first digit cannot be a zero, right? It can't be a zero. So if it can't be a zero and it's binary, it has to be a one. So this first digit is going to be a one. Okay, so you have 1 point something, 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 zeros and ones here, multiplied by 2 to the some power. Okay, so this part is known as the mantissa or the significand. This part's going to be the exponent. Okay, and to kind of store this representation, the computer needs to allocate bits for the sign. It needs to allocate bits for the significand or mantissa, and it needs to allocate bits for the exponent, right? There's three parts, the sign, the mantissa, the exponent, all right? And you always have kind of a leading one in front of the dot or in front of the binary point. And we technically don't need to store it because it's going to be implied to be one for pretty much all of our numbers, okay? And if this were a zero, it would not be scientific notation anymore, okay? So let's say, how should we represent some number like 6.375? This is 6 3/8, okay? So in binary, if we wanted to represent this in binary, we would say, okay, how do we represent the six? The six is 4 + 2 + 0, right? So in front of the binary point, we have 110 for the six, okay? For 0.375, which is equal to 3/8, we have 0 halves, 1/4, and 1/8, right? So we're going to do 1/4 and 1/8. So we have a 4, a 2, no ones, no halves, a 1/4 and 1/8, and that gives us 6.375. This is the equivalent, 110.011. I hope that's all right. Okay, and then if we want to turn this into kind of this normalized scientific notation, right? So I have 110.011. I'm going to turn this into basically scientific notation. And so I'm going to move this point, move the binary point over two places. So instead of 110.011, I'm going to get 1.10011. Okay, and because I moved it over two places, I'm going to say we have to multiply it by 2 to the 2 power, 2 to the 2, which is basically I have to multiply it by 4. All right, and so we think, okay, is this still equal to 6.375? It is, right? So here now I have 1.10011. I have 1's place, the halves place. I got 1/2 here, 0.5 or 1/2. I've got no quarters, no eighths. I have a 16th and I have a 32nd, okay? So I have 0.0625, 0.03125, which is 1/32nd. If I add all of those up, I get 1.59375. And if I multiply it by 2 squared, multiply it by 4, I'm gonna get 6.375 and I get the same value back. Right. And so basically, when we store numbers in our floating point system, there it's kind of like this. Okay. We're going to store these numbers here. Okay. And so, as far as what the IEEE 754 specification says, it says, all right, how many bits do you want to, how many bytes of memory, right? Like, how much space on the computer are we going to dedicate towards storing a number? And they said, you know what, let's use 8 bytes, or let's use 4 bytes or something like that, right? And so a byte is 8 bits. So how many bits are we going to store? So you can have single precision, double precision, and a long double precision. And in R, we have pretty much all of the floating point numbers, all of anything with a decimal in it is stored as type double, right? Type of is double. And that's because it's a double precision. So if you are using programming in C, you can declare variables with single precision that would use only 32 bits in memory. And you would be able to perhaps write a more efficient program and things like that, 32 bits for your numbers and things like that. Over here, we've got 64 bits and things like that, okay? And so as far as the numbers we will have, we got 1 for the sine, 11 for the exponent, 52 for the mantissa, or for the significant, all right? And so 1 plus 11 plus 52, is 64 bits, and that's how those 64 bits get used. Okay, and so this is what it looks like, okay? So we have 64-bit double precision, and that's why we call it type double. And if you think about all of the bits here, okay, we number the bits going from the 0th place to the 63rd, but anyway, you can think of it like this, right? The first bit over here is the sine bit. We've got 11 bits for the exponent, and then we have 52 bits for the fraction or for the mantissa, okay? And so you got 64 places, 64 zeros and ones, and this is how we're going to represent our numbers, okay? And so if you think about these 11 bits that we have for the exponent, okay, we have 11 bits for the exponent. How many unique values can we represent with 11 bits? With 11 bits, we can represent 2 to the 11 unique values, right? So if you think of every single possible combination is of zeros and ones, I've got 11 bits. So 2 to the 11th, I can represent 2048 unique values here, right? Just with these things, okay? And we're going to reserve two of those integers, right? So of the 2048, we're going to reserve some of them, two of them for special cases, okay? And so now I have basically 2046 integers, and we want to be able to represent basically as many positive and negative values that we can, okay? And so what we're going to do is we're going to basically make half of them positive and half of them negative, okay? And so we're going to have, the range is going to go from negative 1022 to 1023, and that covers 2046, because there's also a zero in there, right? So we can't just do negative 1023 to 1023. There, it's negative 1022, zero, 1023, okay? And so, and the integers in this range are stored as basically binary representations that go from one to 2046. So using 11 bits to represent the number one, I got 000000001. And to represent 2046 in binary is 111111110. Okay. And the fact that we're going to go basically this number, 2000, an integer, this, you know, this would represent the number 2046, but it's going to correspond to the number 1023. This means we have what we call an exponent bias of 1023, okay? So the stored value of the exponent is off from this kind of the raw value by subtracting, you know, we subtract off 1023, okay? And you can think of that as going, instead of 2 to the 11, we go 2 to the 10, which is 1024 minus 1. Our bias is 1023, okay? So to represent the actual exponent, we're actually going to add a bias of 1023 to the binary representation, right? And it feels a little strange, okay? But basically, if you think of, again, how many different values can we represent with 11 bits, okay? We can represent 2048 unique values. Okay, and those unique values go from 0 to 2047, okay? And so if we list them all off, in binary, 0 is all zeros, 2047 is 11 bits that are all ones, okay? The zero case has a special function, and the case where it's all ones also has a special function, okay? And so everything else is gonna correspond. So in binary, we got 000001. This is going to correspond to the value negative 1022. And this is going to correspond to the value 1023, okay? And the reason why we want to go from negative 1022 to 1023 is because we want to be able to represent both positive exponents and negative exponents. All right, and so we're basically just kind of shifting everything down. Does that kind of make sense? Let me go ahead and give you your second view quiz answer. Second view quiz answer for today is the letter B. B as in bear. B as in bear or bias or whatever, binary. That's our second view quiz answer for today. Okay. All right. And so again, we said the exponent 2047, which is all ones, has a special case, and that's going to represent either the numbers infinity or NaN. Okay, and we'll talk about those in a moment. Okay, and then if you have all zeros, okay, this is going to be used to represent what we call subnormal or denormalized numbers, which we'll get to again later. Okay, so maybe to kind of further explain this, because I've been talking a lot about this IEEE 754, I think what we'll do is we'll explore something called a mini float, which basically is going to work off of the same principles as the IEEE 754 system, but rather than using 64 bits, we're just going to use 8 bits, okay? 8 bits, and we'll have a similar system. We'll have 1 bit for the sine, 3 bits for the exponent, and 4 bits for the mantissa. This is how we're going to allocate our 8 bits. But we've got a similar system where we got a sine bit, some bits for the exponent, some bits for the mantissa, and we'll see what kind of values we can represent. Okay, now with 8 bits, you can only represent 2 to the 8 unique values, 2 to the 8 unique values, which I think is 128. Wait, what's 2 to the 8? 2 to the 8, I think, is 128, but I could be wrong. 2 to the 5 is 32. 2 to the 6 is 64. Oh, no, 2 to the 8 would be 256. Sorry, 256 unique values. Okay. All right. And so the first bit is going to be our sine bit. Okay. And if it's positive, sine bit 0. And if it's negative, the sine bit is 1. We technically are going to end up having two representations of 0, positive 0 and negative 0. But we're willing to accept that. Okay, so let's think about the exponent, right? So the exponent, we have 3 bits to represent the exponent, and that means we can represent 8 unique values, right? 2 to the 3rd is 8, and we want to be able to represent both positive values and negative values, okay? Positive values and negative values. And so we're going to reserve all 0 and all 1s for special cases, okay? All 0 will be for denormalized numbers. All ones will be for kind of infinity and NaN. So that's a special case. So that gives us basically 6 numbers in between here and here. Okay. And we want to represent positive and negative numbers there. So 001, we're going to subtract a bias of 3. Okay. Because I've got 8 unique values. I start off with 8 unique values. We take away 2, okay? So now I have 6 unique values, right? I take away 2 for special purposes. So I have 6 unique values. We basically want half of them positive and half of them negative. So we're gonna apply a bias of 3. Half of 6 is 3. So we're gonna do each value, we're gonna just subtract 3. So 110, which takes on the value 6, will represent, after we apply the bias, will be a 3. Okay, 101, which becomes a 5, after the bias will become a 2. And 001, which is normally a 1, after the bias becomes negative 2, right? So as far as our exponents, we can represent values going from negative 2 up to positive 3, okay? And then all 0 has a special case and all 1s have a special case. Okay, so that's the 3 bits we apply for the exponent. And now we got 4 bits for the mantissa, 4 bits for the mantissa. And so basically we're always gonna be working in normalized binary scientific notation. We can always assume the digit in front of the dot in front of the binary point is a 1. So we got 1 point, and then we're gonna put in our 4 mantissa bits. Bit, 1, 2, 3, 4, we got 4 bits, and these are where the mantissa bits are gonna go. So what number would these bits represent? What number? Let's work through this example, okay? So this is my sine bit. These 3 are my exponent bits. These are my mantissa bits, okay? Maybe I'll work this out by hand, and then All right, so what do I have? I got 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 1, 1. Okay, so I've already broken up. This is the sine. This is the exponent. And this is the mantissa. Okay, these are my 8 bits. Okay, so sine means it's going to be positive. A zero bit for the sine is positive. Okay, the exponent. All right, what is my exponent? Okay, 1, 0, 1 is equal to 4 plus, we have the 4's place, the 2's place, and the 1's place. So I have 4 plus 1. I got no 2's, so this is going to become a 5. And I have a bias of 3. So this becomes the exponent is 2. And so basically, I'm going to have something, whatever our number is, it's going to be times 2 to the 2 power. Okay. All right. And this part, the mantissa, means I've got 1 point. And the 4 bits are 0, 1, 1, 1, okay? The exponent is going to be times 2 to the 2, okay? So here I've got 1 plus 0 halves plus 1 fourth plus 1 eighth plus 1 16th. And we're going to multiply whatever this is times 4, okay? So I could do this either now or later. So I could do 4 plus 0 plus 1 fourth times 4 is 1, plus 1 eighth times 4 is 1 half, plus 1 16th times 4 is 1 fourth. So this is going to give me 5.75. Is that okay? Does that make sense? I think I've written this out here. Okay, so the sine bit is 0, the exponent bits are 1, 0, 1, the mantissa bits are 0, 1, 1, 1, okay? So the exponent bits are 1, 0, 1, which becomes 5, the exponent bias is 3, exponent value is 2. The mantissa bits are 0, 1, 1, 1, so we plug those in and we get 1.0111 times 2 to the 2, okay? And I think this is the process that I got. So I've got 1 plus, 0 halves plus 1 fourth plus 1 eighth plus 1 16th times 2 squared or times 4. And so that becomes 4 plus 0 plus 1 plus 1 half plus 1 fourth, 5 and 3 quarters. And that's what this number represents, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 1, 1. Okay. All right, so that's how we go from the binary to decimal. All right, so here, okay, let's try working the other way. And I guess I've already started this, okay? But let's say we wanted to represent the number 2.25, okay? In bits. All right, so in binary, 2 will become 1, 0, right? And then 0.25, which is basically 1 fourth, will become 1.0 for the 2 and 0.01. Is that okay? So this is what we have, right? 2.25 is 2 plus 0 ones plus 0 halves plus 1 quarter. So we're going to get 1.01, right? And what we want to do is we want to get this into kind of our float system. Okay, so we need to have 8 bits, right? We've got the sine bit. So this part's easy. The sine bit is 0 because it's positive, right? Okay, and then let's do the mantissa, and then we'll get back to the exponent. Okay, so for the mantissa, we always have 1.0 blank, 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 okay? So how do we get this over? What we're gonna do is we're gonna move the binary point over 1, okay? So if I do that, I'm gonna get 1.001. And so this is basically, I can put in 001, and I have a leftover, so I'm gonna just put in a 0 there, okay? So as far as the mantissa bits will be 0, 0, 1, 0. Those are going to be my mantissa bits, okay? I don't have to worry about this leading one because it's always going to be a leading one, Okay. All right. And then so the last part is for the exponent. How many places did I move it over? I moved it over one place. I moved it over one, right? So the way I would write it, it would be 1.0010 times 2 to the 1, okay? So I need to encode this part, okay? So the exponent is equal to 1. And what I have to do is I have to apply a bias, okay? So this time to go into the bias, we're gonna add 3. And so we're gonna get a 4, okay? And so using 3 bits to represent the number 4, we're gonna have 100. These are gonna be my exponent bits. This is my bias. My bias is a 3, okay? So these are my exponent bits. These are my mantissa bits. This is my sine bit. So all together, so your 8 bits will be 0 for the sine, 100 for the exponent, and 0010 for the mantissa. Okay, and those would be your 8 bits to represent 2.25 in floating point. Okay, so I think I have this. So we're gonna shift this over one dot. So now I have 1.001 times 2 to the 1. So we have sine bit is 0 for because it's positive. Mantissa bits are going to be basically 001. And then we add a trailing 0. So we have a total of 4 bits. Okay. And then why is the bias 3? Okay, the bias is 3 because we have a total of 4 bits. So so again, if we just think about, we have 3 bits for the exponent. We got, and then so we can represent 8 unique values, 0000, 0010, 0011, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100. Okay, so this is 01 in decimal. So we have 8 unique values, 0 through 7. This is special. And this is special. And what we want with these remaining 6, we want to be able to represent both positive. We don't want to just be able to represent 2 to the 1 and 2 through the 6. We want to be able to represent some negative values. And so what we're going to do is we're going to just subtract 3 from everything. We're basically just shifting everything down. And so we're going to just subtract 3. And we can now represent both negative and positive values. Okay. And the reason why we subtract 3 is because half of 6 is 3, okay? So if you think about the unique values that we have that aren't special, okay? We've got 6 unique values, half of that is 3, right? So what if we have 5 bits for the exponent? What would be the bias? Okay, well, we would start off with 5 bits, we have 0. Okay, and then over here, 5 bits over here would be 31, okay? And so how many values do we have from here? We would have, you know, basically 1 through 30 here, okay? And we would want half of those values to be negative. So our bias would be half of 30, okay? And we'd go from 15, so from negative 14 to 15. So our bias would be, okay, and the general rule is if you have I don't know, whatever e exponent bits, the bias is going to equal 2 to the e minus 1 minus 1. That's, I don't know if this is any easier, right? So if you have 3 bits, 3 minus 1 is 2. Okay, yeah, so 2 to the 2 is 4 minus 1 is 3, right? And then here, if we have E is equal to 5 with 5 bits, you know, 2 to the 4 is 16, 16 minus 1 is 15, okay? So the number in binary is 0100010, yeah. Is that okay? 4 in binary is 100. All right, so, you know, again, when we do this in IEEE, we've got 64 bits, 11 for the exponent, 54, 52. All right, oh, we're still working on our mini float, sorry. This is repeated, huh? Okay. All right, oh, here's another example. Okay, why don't you guys try this, okay? Why don't you guys try this one? And then I said, compare your answers with a neighbor. Obviously, you can't do that. But why don't you guys try this? See, with our mini float system. So, you know, pause the video. These are what the exponent bits are. Okay, 3 bits for the exponent, 4 bits for the mantissa. I'm going to go ahead and pause the video, and I want you guys to try this out. Okay, so again, let's go ahead and take a look here, right? So we've got 1010 and then 1010, okay? So again, so here's the sign. The sign's gonna be negative, right? Negative sign, all right. This is the exponent. The exponent is 010, okay? And so 010 corresponds to decimal value 2. And then we apply the bias. In this case, because we're going from exponent to here, we're gonna apply a bias minus 3, we're gonna get negative 1. So whatever it is, we're gonna get something times 2 to the negative 1, okay? And then over here, we got 1010, okay? So we're gonna put this behind our mantissa. We got 1.1010. And basically, we have to take this, whatever this is, and we're going to multiply it by 2 to the negative 1. Okay, so we have a few ways to do this. One way is we can do 1 plus 1 half plus basically 0 fourths plus 1 eighth and 0 sixteenths. Okay, and so I get, what is this? 1 plus 1 half plus 1 eighth. I don't know what that is. 1 half is 5, and then 1 eighth is 0.125. So what is that? 0.625? 1.625 times 2 to the negative 1, and this is negative. So half of this is going to be 0.8125. Okay? And that's going to be our answer. Okay? So we got... negative 1.1010, and again, 1 plus 1 half plus 1 eighth times 2 to the negative 1, negative, and that gives me negative 0.8125. All right, very good, if you got that right. Okay, and then another option that you could do is you could say, well, you know what, I can do the 2 to the negative 1 part first, and so you'll kind of roll the binary point over, and so instead of 1.1010, you can have 0.11010, and that's going to be 1 half, 1 fourth, and 1 16th, which also gives you to negative 0.8125. All right, so we run into a problem. This whole thing, and it's very good that we always assume that there's a leading one, okay? Because it doesn't make sense to have to use a bit of storage to, you know, in cases where like pretty much it's always going to have a leading one, okay? But it does lead to a problem, okay? It does lead to a problem where if we have all zeros here, which intuitively we feel like this should represent the number zero, according to our system, this would represent the number 1/8, okay? And the reason for that is because, you know, we have 4 bits for the mantissa, 3 bits for the exponent, okay? So with the 3 bits for the exponent, we get a negative, you know, we get 0 minus 3, we get negative 3. and then 4 bits for the mantissa, we get 1.0000. Okay. And because we're always assuming there's a leading one, we're going to get basically 1 × 2⁻, which is going to be 1/8. Okay. And this is not what we want. We don't want this. We don't want this. Okay. So what's part of the IEEE 754 system is that, you know what, when we have all zeros for the exponent, it's a special case, we enter what's called denormalized mode, okay? Denormalized mode. And this happens when all of the exponent bits are zero. We're going to change this rule where the digit in front of the mantissa, this part in front of the binary point, we're not gonna assume as a one, we're now going to let it be zero, okay? So this is why we call it denormalized mode, is because, you know, under normalized scientific notation, the digit in front of that binary point should always not be zero, right? It should, you always need to have something other than zero, you know, as your first digit. And now we're gonna say that first digit is zero. And so this is denormalized mode, okay? Now, in order to kind of get this to work and in order to prevent a discontinuity in the numbers, when you are in denormalized mode, this is where things get even a little bit more confusing. The exponent bias is one less than usual, okay? So with our mini float system, our bias, we've been applying a bias of 3, okay? When you're in denormalized mode, you're gonna apply a bias of 2. In double precision floating point, when you have 11 bits for the exponent, normally your bias is 1023. You subtract 1023 from whatever number you have. When you enter denormalized mode, you subtract one less than that. You subtract only 1022, okay? It feels weird. But it works out, okay? So let's revisit this case of all zeros. And we're gonna have all zeros in the exponent, okay? We're now in denormalized mode, okay? So our bias is gonna be one less than usual. So we have a bias of 2, our exponent is -2. The mantissa bits are all zero. We got 4 bits for the mantissa, they're all zero. And in denormalized mode, the leading digit is zero. So I've got 0.0000 × 2⁻². And that's just zero. Okay, well, that's not that exciting, but it does work out where when you have all zeros here, you get zero. And that is what we want. We want all zeros, and that's what we have here. The other case that's special is when the exponents are all ones. It also has a special meaning. So all zeros mean we're in denormalized mode, and all ones are special. And with all ones, you have infinity, okay? Infinity means the exponent bits are all one and the mantissa bits are all zero, okay? Mantissa bits all zero, exponent bits all one. This will give us infinity, and we have positive infinity and negative infinity, okay? And in R, you can represent, how do I do infinity? All right, it's just INF. Okay, INF. INF is infinity. All right, so you have positive infinity and you have also negative infinity. And if you ask what's the type of for INF, it's a type double, okay? And that's because it's stored as basically using the floating point system. Similarly, we have NaN, not a numbered NaN, which is what we get if we do something like 0/0, you get NaN. Or if you do like infinity minus infinity, you also get NaN, all right? And in these cases, if you ask what is type of for NaN, it's also type double, okay? Type double, okay? And the mantissa bits is any combination of bits other than all zero, right? So the exponent bits are all one. So you have all ones in the exponent. And then the mantissa bits is some combination other than all zeros. That's going to be NaN, okay? Okay, so the smallest value that we can represent that's not zero, the smallest, I guess, smallest positive non-zero value that we can represent will be this. We're in denormalized mode. We have a positive value, positive sign, denormalized mode, and these are our mantissa bits, okay? So what number is this? Okay, so I've got 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, okay? And so it's positive. This is denormalized. So we are gonna have times 2 to the -2, okay? This is, you know, we do 0 minus, and then, you know, 1 less than the bias, bias minus 1. So our bias is normally 3. This time we're gonna just subtract 2. So 0 minus 2 is -2, okay? So this is what we have. Our exponent is gonna be something, something, something times 2 to the -2. And this part being my mantissa, now I have 0.0001, okay? No longer a leading one. Not a leading one, okay? So I have basically 0/2 plus 0/4 plus 0/8 and 1/16, okay? So my final number is gonna be basically 1/16 times 2 to the -2, or basically times 1/4, and I'm gonna get 1/64, okay? And whatever that is, I don't know what 1/64 is, some really small value, right? Okay, so the leading digit is 0, we're at 2 to the -2. We got 1/16 times 2 to the -2, which is 1/64, and that's gonna be 0.015625. 1/64 here, all right? Is that all right? Getting 1/64 here? Great. Okay, so then the next smallest value we can represent is we'll just kind of roll this up, okay? And so now I got 1, 0. And basically if we follow this whole process, all right? Now I've got the exponent part is still the same, 2 to the -2. The mantissa bits are 0, 0, 1, 0, okay, times 2 to the -2. This is 0.0010 is 1/8, and times 2 to the -2 is 1/4. That's 1/32 or 2/64, right? So going from the smallest value, which was 1/64, the second smallest value is 2/64. So we're incrementing by a step of 1/64, okay? So we go from 1/64 to 2/64. The next value would be 3/64, 4/64, 5/64, 6/64, okay? So on and so forth. We're gonna keep incrementing by 1/64. So the increment between these values is 1/64, okay? And these are still all denormalized because the 3 exponent bits are all 0, okay? So let's keep counting, okay? And then so eventually the largest denormalized value we can have will be 1, 1, 1, 1 here for the mantissa, and the exponent bits are still all zeros, right? That means we're still denormalized. Okay, the largest denormalized value we can have, we'll have 0, 0, 0 for the exponent. So our exponent is still -2. The mantissa bits are now all ones, 1, 1, 1, 1. And so in denormalized mode, the leading digit is 0. We got 0.1111. times 2 to the -2. So this is 1/2 plus 1/4 plus 1/8 plus 1/16. This is 15/16. 1, 1, 1, 1. 0.1111 is 15/16. Times 1/4 gives me 15/64. Okay. 15/64. And then now we go on. And now we're in normalized mode. Okay. Now we're in normalized mode. So the next value, after this becomes all ones, the next thing, now we have 0, 0, 1, And these are all zeros now. So the exponent bits are one. This is the smallest kind of normalized exponent that we can have. So now our bias is three, which is kind of the usual bias that we apply, not one smaller. So with the bias of three, our exponent is going to be one minus three. We're at negative two. So we're still multiplying by two to the negative two. Mantissa of bits are all zeros. The leading digit is a one. So I have 1.0000 times two to the negative two. This is going to be one times two to the negative two, which is just 1/4. Okay. And if we think about, well, what is 1/4 equal to? 1/4 is 16/64. So we've gone from 15/64 to 16/64. Okay. And our increment is still 1/64. And if we think of the next value that we can represent, we've got 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1. Okay. And so this is 1.0001. So that's basically 1 + 1/16. This part, the exponent is still 2 to the -2. And so this becomes 17/64. 17/64. So far we've been counting by 64ths, right? We've been counting by 64ths. We started off at, back here, we started off with 1/64, and we got to 2/64, 3/64, 4/64, 5/64, 6/64. We got up to 15/64, 16/64, 17/64. Okay, we go, okay, well, we just keep counting up by 64ths, okay? But not so, okay? Eventually, so we'll go 18/64, 19/64, 20/64, so on and so forth. And eventually we'll get up to this point where this part, the mantissa fills up with all ones. And this part is still the exponent, okay? So this is the exponent, this is mantissa. All right, what is this value? This value, 31/64. I don't think we're surprised here, right? If we keep counting up by 64ths, if we keep incrementing, we're gonna get up to 31/64. Okay? And then what's the next value that comes after that? Okay, well, I think we can figure this out. We'd say, oh, that's gonna be 32/64, right? 32/64, right? These will all become zeros. The exponents will go from 0, 0, 1 to 0, 1, 0, right? That's the next thing that we can have, right? Exponent right now is basically one with a bias of three, becomes negative two. The next part is gonna become 0, 1, 0, which is two, and with a bias, it'll become a negative one. So we will, the next value will be here, 0, 1, 0, and these have all become zeros. Okay, we've kind of incremented. So our exponent is now negative one. And when we do all of this calculation, we have 1 × 2^-1, that becomes 1/2. And we are at 32/64, okay? 32/64. So far, so good? Yes. All right, so this is where the genius of floating point numbers comes in. And the next number, okay, we're gonna change this to a one. We're gonna change this to a one, okay? And what is this? This is not 33/64. It is 34/64, okay? So if you go through the process here, our exponent is 0, 1, 0, so that's a 2 minus or bias of 3. Our exponent is negative 1. The mantissa bits are 0, 0, 0, 1, leading digits 1, so that becomes 1.0001. That's 1 + 1/16 times 2^-1, so that becomes 17/16 times 1/2, or 17/32, or 34/64. So we went from 32/64 to 34/64, okay? Our increment is 1/32, or 2/64. There is no way, it is not possible to represent the number 33/64 with our floating point system, okay? With 8 bits, where 3 are the exponent and 4 are the mantissa, there's no way for us to represent the number 33/64. We can represent 32/64 with this number, and we can represent 34/64 with this number, okay? But we cannot represent something in between this. If you look at these numbers and this, there's we can't represent any value in between there. So we can't represent anything between 32 and 34/64. We cannot represent like 33/64. It's not possible, okay? That is what floating point arithmetic means. It says you have a certain number of digits, and depending on whether the value is small or value is large, kind of the step size between them is gonna change. And so when we get to this point, our increment is now 30 seconds, okay? So we went from basically 1/2 or 16 30 seconds to 17 30 seconds. And if you think about, okay, what's the next number that we get? It's gonna be 18 30 seconds, okay? So if you think about the next number going from 001, you know, 01, the next part becomes here, the anticipates become this. This is 1 + 1/8 times 1/2. That becomes 9/16 or 18 30 seconds, okay? And so our increment is now 30 seconds. And so if we go through that, we'll go 18 30 seconds, 19 30 seconds, 20 30 seconds, 21 over 32, 22 over 32. And eventually we will get to this part, which is equal to 31 over 32, okay? 1 + 1/2 + 1/4 + 1/8 + 1/16 times 2^-1, that's 31 over 32. And then the next value we get will become this, and this is equal to 1, okay? This is equal to 1. Exponent bits are 0, 1, 1. That's with a bias of 3, that's gonna become 0. And the mantissa bits are all 0, so we have 1.0 times 2^0, which is just 1. That's 32 over 32, okay? And what's the increment now? Okay, so what's the next number that comes in the sequence? Okay, well, we're gonna go from 000 to 001. And what is this? This is 1 + 1/16 or 17/16. Okay, and so as our numbers get bigger, now we cannot represent something in between 1 and 17/16, right? If you want to represent 30 seconds, you cannot do that, okay? We had 1, which is 32 over 32. We have 17, which is 34 over 32. But if you wanted to do 33 over 32, you can't do it, okay? It's not possible. It's not possible. And so we can keep counting, and we get 16/16, 17/16, 18/16, 19/16, and eventually we'll reach up this point, 31 over 16. And then what's the next value there? It's gonna become 2. And at 2, the step sizes are gonna become 8s, okay? We have 16 over 8, 17 over 8, 18 over 8, 19 over 8, and eventually we will reach 31 over 8. Okay, and then after that, we will reach 32 over 8. 32 over 8 is 4, or 16/4, and now our increment becomes 1/4. And so we get 16/4, 17/4, 18/4, 19/4. Keep going all the way up until we get to 31/4, okay? So I hope these slides kind of make it clear what's happening, right? So you think about kind of the denominator, and we keep going 16, 17, 18, 19 up to 31, 16, 17, 18, 19 up to 31. But this time our step sizes are 8s, and now our step sizes are 1/4. Okay, so 31 over 4 is basically almost 8, 7 and 3/4. Okay, and then the next thing, 7 3/4 after that will become 8, and our step size becomes 1/2, okay? And we count up by halves now. We got 8, 17 halves, 8 1/2, 18 over 2, 9, 9 1/2, 10, 10 1/2, And we get all the way up to here, 31 over 2, 15.5. And this is actually the largest number we can represent with our floating point system. This is the largest number because the next number after this, this is infinity. This is our floating point representation of infinity, okay? We have all ones in the exponent, all ones in the exponent, all zeros in the mantissa. This is our floating representation for infinity. So the largest value that we can represent with our mini floating point system is 15.5. That's the largest value that we can represent with our mini floating point system. Anything bigger than this, we try to represent it, is gonna get turned into infinity, okay? If we're using 8 bits and following kind of the IEEE 754 standard, the largest value we can represent is 15.5, largest positive non-infinite value, 15.5. Okay, how do we feel about this? All right, thanks. I appreciate your thumbs up. All right, let me go ahead and give you your last view quiz answer. Last view quiz answer for today is A as in apple. A as in apple is your last view quiz answer. A as in apple is the last view quiz answer. All right, let's take a look at some of these things, okay? So if we think about the full double precision floating point number, right? Our sine bit is 0, our exponent, we have 11 bits, okay? And so normally our bias is 1023 with, if we're in denormalized mode, our bias will be 1022, okay? And we got 51 bits for the mantissa. All right, so what is the absolute smallest positive value that I can represent? Smallest positive non-zero value, okay? So here in denormalized mode, I would have a 0 point, and then I would have basically 51 zeros followed by a 1 bit, okay? And then I would be multiplied by 2 × 10⁻². 2 to the -1022, okay? And so if you do that, this becomes 2 to the -1074. This is the absolute smallest number I can represent on the machine. And this is anything, so if I do this, if I do 2 to the -1074, I get a number. If I try to do anything smaller than this, so if I say this is A, okay? Here's A. If I just say, what's A divided by 2? It's gonna zero out, okay? If you try to ask for anything smaller than this, it's gonna say, I can't do it, okay? It becomes 0. We cannot represent anything smaller than this on the computer. Okay, what's the smallest normalized value? The smallest normalized value, all right, so this is the smallest denormalized value. The smallest normalized value, we have a positive sine bit. Our exponent will be pretty much all zeros and then a 1, right? So that way we're still in normalized mode, okay? All zeros and a 1, okay? Our bias is 1023. So our exponent is gonna be 1 − 1023, 10⁻². And I've got all zeros for the mantissa. So I've got 1.0 × 2⁻², okay? So 1 × 2⁻², okay? This is my smallest normalized value. This is known as double X min, okay? So you can ask for properties of your system. You can do dot machine and it prints off a whole bunch of stuff. And you can do, dot machine $double.xmin, okay? And that's the same value, 2 raised to the -1022. This is the smallest normalized value. Now you can take this, right? I can do B is this, and I can ask for you know, A is this, and, you know, it can still do B divided by 2, and it works and things like that, okay? But this is the smallest normalized value, and it gets a special name. It's known as double X-min. Okay. What's the next smallest normalized value that I can add? Okay. So here, if we think about this, so the smallest normalized, these we had all zeros for the mantissa. Here, I'm adding 51 zero bits, okay? And a 1 bit, okay? So now I have 1.00000 ending with a 1 times 2 to the negative 1022, okay? And and so here I can say x is 2 to the negative 1022, right? And then y we'll say is 1 plus 2 to the negative 52 times 2 to the negative 1022. Okay, so here's x, here's y, and these are not the same. Is x equal to y? They are not, right? If I try to add something smaller, right? So let's do z. If I say z is 1 plus, say, 2 to the negative 53. 2 to the negative 53. Instead of 2 to the negative 52, if I try to do that, and I say times 2 to the negative 1022, okay? If I say here's x and here's z, and is x equal to z? They are exactly equal to each other, all right? I cannot add a value smaller than 2 to the negative 52, okay? So if I can add, because I have 52 bits in the mantissa, so I can have 51 zero bits followed by one, and that's basically the smallest increment. If I try to do anything smaller than that, I would need more bits in the mantissa, and I don't have that. And so if I try to do 1 plus 2 to the negative 53, 1 plus 2 to the negative 53, the computer is not able to actually store that number. It's not able to distinguish that from x, okay? So the smallest value that you can add to 1 and have it be distinct from 1 is known as machine epsilon, okay? So we kind of saw a little bit of this, right? So if I have 1, and I can do 1 plus 2 to the negative 52, and I will get a distinct value from 1, right? So if I say x is equal to 1, and y is equal to 1 plus 2 to the negative 52, here I have x, here I have y, and is x equal to y? They are not, right? Because I can add 2 to the negative 52, and it becomes a distinct value. If I try to add anything smaller than that, right? So 2 to the negative 53. 2 to the negative 53, I can calculate this value, right? So let's call this P. If I do, let's do Z is equal to 1 plus P. Okay? Is Z and X the same? They are. Okay, P is equal to this, but I cannot add 1 and P together, okay? Because P is 2 to the negative 53. I cannot add 2 to the negative 53 to 1. I don't have enough spaces to store it, okay? But if I had a Q, which is 2 to the negative 52, okay, I can do 1 plus Q, and that will be something, okay? So is 1 equal to 1 plus P? Yes. Is 1 equal to 1 plus Q? No, okay? So 1 plus Q gives me a distinct value because Q is 2 to the negative 52, but 1 plus P does not because P is 2 to the negative 53. I don't have enough bits to store the value needed to get 1 plus 2 to the negative 53. right? And so this value, 2 to the negative 52, which is the absolute smallest thing that you can add so that it's distinct, this is known as machine epsilon, okay? So if I do dot machine, dollar sign, double epsilon, that is this value, okay? This value, 2 to the negative 52 is this machine double epsilon. This is the smallest value you can add to 1 and have it be a value distinct from 1, okay? So here I showed you, so the question was, is a 2 to the negative 53 value the reason why R doesn't run sometimes? I don't know. I don't know. All I'm saying is you can't, you can't store it on here, right? So, you know, for example, here I have this calculator and it has 8 spaces, right? So on this calculator, I can store values like 0.00001, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Actually, this is not a good example, but with 8 decimal places, you know, because I would run out of space if I tried to do like, so here I can have point, a whole bunch of zeros and a one. So 3 leading zeros and a one. If I try to add that to say 100, it can't represent that number, right? Because I would need more spaces. I would need 100.0000070 zeros and a one. And that would require something like 10 digits of screen space. And I don't have that, okay? I only have 8 digits of screen space, right? And similarly, in order to store something like 1 plus 2 to the negative 53, okay? Which is what I'm trying to do here, 1 plus 2 to the negative 53, I would need more bits in my floating point representation, and I can't do it, okay? So as far as A and B goes, if I do 1 and 1 plus 2 to the negative 53, the computer can't tell the difference between A and B, okay? It can tell the difference between X and Y where I added 2 to the negative 52, but it can't tell the difference between A and B where I've tried to add 2 to the negative 53 to 1, okay? And it's gonna be different. So when you have, so here I have, what was it? P is 2 to the negative 53 and Q is 2 to the negative 52, right? So I can do 1 plus Q and I get that. But I cannot do 2 plus Q. 2 plus Q is the same thing as 2. So if I do, is 2 equal to 2 plus Q? That's going to end up being true. 1 plus Q is distinct. Whoops. Okay. But 2 plus Q, okay, because we've rolled to the next phase. So if I have R is equal to 2 to the negative 51, okay, 2 plus R is going to be distinct from 2. 2 is equal to 2 plus R, that's false. But if I try to do 2 plus Q, Q being 2 to the negative 52, I can't do it, okay? But then if I go to the next spot, 4 plus R, that the computer can't distinguish, right? So every time I kind of increment, right, by a power of 2, the smallest value I can store has to increment also, right? So at 1, I can add 2 to the negative 52. When I get to 2s, the smallest value I can add is 2 to the negative 51. When I get to 4s, the smallest value I can add is 2 to the negative 50, and so on and so forth, right? Because we run out of space as we kind of move up the number line. Right. As we move up the number line, the increments between things have to get larger. Okay. So to represent the number 1 in IEEE 754, we have to have because our bias is 1023, the exponent in bits is going to be 1023, so that this kind of becomes 2 to the 0. So we get 0, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. And then all the bits in the mantissa will be zero, right? And I think this makes it clear why the smallest number I can add is going to be 2 to the -52, because all I can do is increment this last bit here to a one, okay? If I try to do anything smaller, I can't represent it, okay? So one plus machine epsilon is pretty much the exact same thing, but I've changed the last bit here to a one, okay? And this is why it's not possible to add anything smaller than 2 to the -52 to the number one. Okay. All right. So here's a thought experiment. Okay. Imagine running this code. While true, x is x plus one. So we just keep adding the number one to x, right? We start off at zero and we just keep adding one. Okay. And we just let it run for a year and we come back. Okay. What is the value of x going to be? What do you think? What do you think is it's gonna be? Any guesses? We're adding, so it's gonna get bigger. Okay, so x is not gonna reach infinity. It's not even gonna get x double max. It's gonna get stuck at 2 to the 53. Okay, so let me just show you what happens. Okay, so you can let it run for a long time, and we can say, let me wipe out my computer here, workspace. So let me just kind of take this. So start off with x. So here's x, and I'm going to do x plus one, and we're going to store that back into x. Okay, so I can add one. And it increments and it gets bigger. And then I'm stuck. If I try to add one, I can't do it. I can't add one anymore. Why? What is this value? Okay, this is 2 to the 53. 2 to the 53 is this, okay? And so at 2 to the 53, the increment size has reached a point where the increment is size 2, and you can't add one anymore. Okay, so I can do 2 to the 53 plus 2, and that works. 2 to the 53 plus 4 works. But if I try to do 2 to the 53 plus 3, it doesn't know how to do that. Okay, or 2 to the 53 plus 1, it can't do it. Okay, so is 2 to the 53 the same thing as 2 to the 53 plus 1? Oh, double equals. Okay, yeah, it sees it as the same. Okay, at this point, the increment is size 2, and you have to add values of at least size 2 in order to kind of increment it, okay? And so we can keep adding 2, and eventually we're gonna get stuck. So so here we can do this, and here I can add x plus 2, x plus 4, x plus 6, x plus 8, x plus, and at this point, the increment, once you get to this spot, which I think is 2 to the 54, okay, at 2 to the 54, if you try to add 2, it doesn't work. Okay, if you try to add one, it doesn't work. It gives you back the same number. At this point, you have to start adding fours to it, okay? At 2 to the 54, the step size is now 4, okay? So as the numbers get bigger, the step sizes increase. Okay? Step size is now 2, and that works, okay? All right, and so the largest possible, let's think about the largest possible number that we can represent. This would be 0 here, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 0, because we can't have all ones. We can't have all ones in the thing. That would give us infinity. And we have all ones in the mantissa, okay? And so this number is basically, basically 2 to the 0 plus 2 to the -1 plus 2 to the -2, all the way up to 2 to the negative 52. So I have 2 raised to the 0 multiplied by 2 to the 1023. Okay. And this gives me what's known as machine double X max. This is the biggest possible number we can represent in the floating point system before it becomes infinity. Okay. Anything bigger than this, if I try to add anything to this, okay, if I try to add anything to this that would distinguish it from itself, which would be 2 to the 970, okay, if you try to add that, it becomes infinity, right? So the smallest possible increment that you can add, right? If you try to add anything smaller, at this point, it's a really big number. So the increment size is 2 to the 969. If you try to add 2 to the 969, it doesn't distinguish it. It thinks it's exactly the same, right? So here's A plus 2 to the 969. It thinks it's exactly the same. It's the same issue here where we have 2 to the 54 plus 2 is the same thing as 2 to the 54. Okay, at this point, the increment size is so much bigger that if I try to add 2 to the 969, it still doesn't distinguish that. But if I try to add 2 to the 970, that blows up and it becomes infinity. So anything, trying to add anything there becomes infinity. All right, so what to do, okay? Well, if you go on checking values like this, 1 plus 2, 1.1 plus 0.2, is that equal to 0.3? You're going to get values like false, okay? And so what you can do instead is you can use this function called all equal. The default tolerance is the square root of machine epsilon. And basically, it's going to just check to see if two values are nearly equal, okay? So we're going to just say A is 0.1 plus 0.2, B is 0.3. Are those equal to each other? Is A and B equal to each other? And that's going to come back true. Right? Rather than doing this straight equality. So this is not recommended if you are dealing with floating point numbers. If you're dealing with decimals, if you're dealing with integers, sure, equals is fine, okay? But if you're dealing with floating point numbers, using straight equality is not a good idea, just because you can run into issues like this, where you're thinking these values should be equal, but they're not actually equal. And so we would recommend using something like all equal. And generally, most programming languages will have some kind of function that tests for near equality, okay? And so these are just a few more examples between all equal and nearly equal and things like that, okay? All right, okay, so we'll end there. And so that's our discussion on floating point numbers. I appreciate you guys coming to class. I appreciate you, those of you who are watching on YouTube, and we will see you guys on Monday. Have a good weekend. All right, have a good night.